गुड आफ्टरनून अदिति।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
ओके गुड आफ्टरनून मिस प्रिया, विल स्टार्ट जस्ट इन अ मिनट। Good afternoon. Today we have joined together to know a little more about experiential learning and what role it plays, especially during today's requirement of learning through experience. So I'm Deepika Kagliwal, welcoming you to the webinar for experiential learning, that is learning through experience and reflection, on 5th of January 2021. Just a minute. Okay, so what is experiential learning? First and foremost, learning through experience and reflection. The question is, what is experience? Would any one of you like to comment on what exactly constitutes experience? I know I'm starting with a question, but that is how it is. What is experience? What constitutes experience? And how is it helpful in learning? Is it helpful in learning? Okay, no comments, no problem. So, what constitutes experience and is it overrated? Now, let me give you a very simple example. When I teach literature, or when we are talking about language, and I keep on using terms like abusive language, motivational language, or encouraging language and all, I don't think until and unless I give you, I give my students a practical example of what exactly abusive language sounds like, what motivational language sounds like, or what encouragement sounds like. Using the terms is not enough. Is it overrated? Absolutely not. In fact, before the advent of the academic way of getting knowledge, our ancestors, everyone in the world, they learned through experience. Every part of information, everything that we now know as knowledge, has been built up from those small particles, small fragments of experience, people's experiences. The simplest example, a burnt child dreads fire. Not because he knows that fire is hot, but because the child has experienced scathing. Before we go forward, I would like to share a small video with you all, and then maybe it will be a little more relevant. As I said, experiences, they are the better source of learning. So just give me a minute as I play the video. Just give me a minute. I'm sorry, technology, I'm experiencing something which I'm going to remember. I'm sorry, I think I'm facing network issues. Am I audible? I am, the video is not playing. I'm really sorry about the inconvenience caused. Fine, doesn't matter. It's all right. So, what is experiential learning? Tell me about your experiences in class, first of all. And has any of your experience left a lasting impact on you? How many of you like going for field trips? How many of us like watching videos? How many of us actually like to hold a debate? Yes. Sarthak, Riddhi, Aditi, Ashish. Yeah, I don't need a thumbs up. I want an experience. Anushka. Okay, I am sure many of you are not very much fan of writing your reflections, right? But your assessment doesn't get over before you write your reflection. So what role does the reflection play in your learning? Because your experiential learning has a major chunk of reflecting on your learning. What is reflection? We are not going to go ahead until and unless you speak about it. So that's the case.
Reflection is like what we, if we do something, so what we learn from it, the good points and the bad points.
Is it always the learning? Or could it also be something that we have experienced, something where we felt something, there were certain emotions involved, something which made you feel happy, something which made you kind of regret? What could be the different reflections? Okay, I am sure during your classes, you have heard speeches by Greta Thunberg. Right?
Yes.
Did it add to your learning experience? And how?
Well, last year we saw her speeches for like the purpose of learning speeches and how to like carry the campaign, so it did help like her international, how she speaks and what does she do in a speech, that helped.
Yes. Okay. So I'm sorry for interrupting. Finally, the video has started. So let's watch this first. Is it visible and
experiential
audible?
Learning theory draws on the work of prominent 20th century thinkers who made experience a central role in their theories of human learning and development. David Kolb synthesized the work of these foundational scholars to develop a holistic model of experiential learning theory. Learning is the process whereby knowledge is created through the transformation of experience. This is ELT in a nutshell. The theory is built on 6 propositions that are shared by the foundational scholars. Learning outcome is not an endpoint, but simply a resting point of an ongoing learning process. As we learn new ideas, we also modify and dispose of old ones. Effective learners are capable of balancing the opposing modes in the learning cycle. Learning never ends. It encompasses all life stages, from childhood to adolescence to middle and old age. When learners and the environment interact, both are changed. We do not simply respond to the environment, but we recreate it to meet our needs. Every field requires unique skills and a special learning process. Learning to develop skills in empathic listening is different than learning skills in engineering. Since its emergence in the early 1970s, there have been over 90,000 experiential learning citations, and ELT has been used to create countless educational courses in multiple fields. Since 2000, ELT research in many fields around the world has more than quadrupled. Experiential learning theory is highly interdisciplinary, addressing learning and educational issues in at least 30 academic disciplines. More and more institutions and educators are experimenting with experiential learning practices beyond higher education. In recent years, K-12 institutions, business organizations, and non-formal organizations have embraced ELT to respond to the learning needs of their clients and constituents. Through recursive cycles of experience, discussion, feedback, and practice and application in real-life context, learners report increased levels of critical thinking abilities and the capacity to apply and connect theoretical knowledge with real-life application. Like Kurt Lewin said, there is nothing so practical as a good theory. And like David Hunt said, there is nothing so theoretical as a good practice. ELT continues to be renewed and enriched through the collective experience of those who apply the theory in their practices around the world. As the workplace, marketplace, and global environment continue to evolve, experiential learning theory is designed to respond to the educational needs of the 21st century.
Okay, so experiential learning theory says it is designed or it is the most effective now for the 21st century. Now I want you to please reflect on how we use experiential learning. Just a minute. I am sorry. Okay, so let me give you a very simple example. How many of you have tried the DIY videos, either in cooking or making some artwork or learning a new skill? And how many times have that been a fiasco? Or you have learned through your experience what works and what doesn't work?
What works and what doesn't work? Someone many or...
Okay, Miss Priya, first time when you tried baking a cake through a video, what was the result?
Result, one time it was very fine, but the next time the cake was, the cake was little uncooked. We can say it was the opposite what I saw in the image or the video last pic.
Right. Yeah,
definitely.
Okay, so that has added to your experience, and now you know experience that you cannot always rely only on the timer mentioned in the recipe or in the video, but you have to take certain decisions on your own. So you reflected on it. What could have been the reason that your cake remained uncooked or it did not turn out as well as it was shown there? So then we get into the process of finding out the reasons for things that did not turn out as we expected them to.
Yeah.
Right. So experiential learning is basically, it is not only theoretical, but it is your own experiences add to your knowledge and to your information. And it's an ongoing process. It works in a cycle. So that actions, the cycle starts with first action, because to gain experience, you have to have your own action in the first place. After your action, you get the reflection as in your case that maybe it worked for the first time, second time it did not work. So it needs certain changes. It needs certain adjustments on your side. After that, after the reflection, you have built up on your knowledge, which you might be ready to share with others, which you might be using later and further. And from that, you have built on your personal, your mind has registered that information for further use. Using the chunk of information, you again take up an action, you again reflect on that, and that is how the learning, the cycle of experiential learning goes on. And it keeps on going throughout your life. The best point I liked about the video is that learning outcome is never the end point. The outcome, the end point, is always the beginning point of something new. Every day we observe things, we listen to things, we are seeing others doing things. We are, our mind, in fact, all our senses, all our five senses are constantly in the stage of gathering information from our surroundings. It is our mind which dictates consciously what information we are taking in and what and how we are synthesizing that information to be used for our benefit, for our learning, for our day-to-day life, in real life. Okay, so let me quickly share with you all what the cycle of experiential learning looks like. Before that, I want to stress on the fact that gone are the days when the teachers were standing in front of a blackboard with a single notebook in hand with images and illustrations and children trying to understand what exactly that image means. I know it's going to sound silly, but I remember the first time I saw a map. I think I might have been in second standard or third standard. And for me, to visualize the concept of a round earth or the map as a flat kind of a drawing there, if I held the map like this, I thought, okay, I'm living in Maharashtra, so I am on the ground. So if I go to Kashmir, that means I'm going to the sky, because I did not understand the concept of different dimensions. I did not understand that north has to be somewhere on the flat surface. I always imagined, and plus, thanks to literature, thanks to the language, Kashmir is a paradise. So that added to my understanding that Kashmir is somewhere in the sky. It took me more than 2 or 3 years to actually try to understand that it is not like this. It's not a four-dimensional thing. It is the flat surface of Earth on which the map is based. Or when my teacher kept on saying, my geography teacher specifically, kept on saying that the Earth rotates and revolves, rotates and revolves. I understood the concept of revolving, going round and round, but I did not understand what spinning meant till my teacher actually took the effort of standing and going round and round and round like that, showing that this is spinning, and while I spin, I also revolve. That was my first tryst with experiential learning. And that is when I realized it doesn't matter if my teacher makes me write 50 times revolve, rotate, revolve, rotate, revolve, rotate. If I don't understand what is the difference between rotating and revolving, writing those spellings 100 times is not going to help me understand the concept of how days and nights are formed or what causes seasons and all those. So that is what my experience of experiential learning started with. Same happened with fractions. So I could never understand. Yes, of course, now I do. But when I started learning fractions in school, I could never understand that how, if I see a number 4, 1 upon 4, if I see the number 4, how is that number smaller than 1? I didn't understand it. Somehow my brain was so stuck on the fact that number 4 is greater than 1, number 10 is greater than 1. So if a number is showing me 1 upon 10, then that means that number is a big number. It took, again, my teacher to show me, okay, this is one whole chocolate. I'm cutting it in these many pieces. So this piece is that much. So she had to give me that experience. If you give me one small piece of it, am I satisfied? No. Because you have not given me one whole chocolate. And that is when I understood what fractions were. So let me quickly show you what experiential learning cycle looks like, and then we'll be open for questions.
Storytelling or
Miss Priya, the storytelling session was at 9:30. I'll be putting the recording on Facebook later, and you can see it from there. There. I'm so sorry, that session was at 9:30 in the morning. Okay, so this is what experiential learning looks like. Active experimentation, which helps us to test our conclusion or maybe to test something new that we have done. It leads us to concrete experience, which we get by acting, doing, and having a hands-on experience. Then we need to go to reflective observation. That is, look back and assess. Did I enjoy doing it? Was it ethically correct? Was it the right way of doing it? What went well, what not so well? And here I would like to remind my students, especially when you're working on your personal projects, remember, your personal project journey is not only about success. It's okay. At least you're learning that what seemed to be very simple is not exactly like that. So you are also using your experiential learning cycle when you are reflecting on your personal project journey, right? And then abstract conceptualization means make sense of the experience and draw conclusions. So this is what your experiential learning cycle looks like. I would like either Anushka or Riddhi to comment on how your personal project journey is an example of experiential learning. Anushka, would you like to comment, please?
Ma'am, in my case, when I'm writing a book, I think I could connect my personal experience a lot. While writing the book, like before, I did not realize that some of the experiences in my life actually meant something. But while writing, when I look back at it, it kind of seems like a learning experience now.
Okay, and what is the abstract conclusion that you have reached through that? How are you going to utilize it? How can that abstract conclusion be used to an active action?
Ma'am, that way I can, in my personal project, I can use it for like the protagonist herself, that she faces all of these little experiences throughout her life, but does not realize actually what they are teaching her. Until she actually reaches the moment of epiphany, when she realizes what all it has taught her.
Right. And I can see the words like experiences, epiphany and all. Now that is built on your experience of how you found these words, how you actually didn't stumble upon them, but you kind of experience them. And that is why you are able to use them well when in an articulate manner when you are trying to express yourself, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Prithi, would you like to comment on experiential learning?
Yes, ma'am. Like for my song, I had to select a global issue. So for the lyrics and all, I really needed to go in depth for like what all people experience, and so I could connect it with what I've read in the books and what I've seen on social media, and like people share their stories and stuff, so that helped me. It added to my experience, like what all.
Everything added a little bit of to your understanding of what global issues are, what discrimination is.
Yes.
All right.
Yes,
thank you so much.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Anything that you would like to comment on? Ms. Priya?
Yes, ma'am. I would like to ask you, how should we create interest to learn more and more things?
You can create interest when you are giving a first-hand experience to children about whatever you're trying to create. If you are talking about language, as I said, I was reluctant for mathematics initially because I realized no matter how much I tried, my experience with numbers was so limited that I couldn't understand what exactly they wanted me to do. I thought, why were there word problems? Just give me the number, I'll do what you want me to do with the number. Why are you giving me such long texts to read first? So I was actually averted from that. When it came to understanding subjects like specifically geography, I'm telling you, I had seen my friends being very much interested in doing map work. I could never understand that. Maybe that had something to do with my conceptualization, or maybe not having enough experience of how to work with them, or to be able to visualize what it meant because of the lack of the resources at those times. But after I understood, now I think I find myself more interested in knowing more. So the reluctance to learn comes from maybe somewhere where I'm not able to connect it, how it can be used in my day-to-day life. Once I have made a connection to those things, I'm sure I will be more interested in knowing if I know how it is applicable.
How can we this experiential learning for children, especially in English subject, because English subject we can't use any object to give them in hand to experience anything. Like if in science we can give something, if we are teaching about a fruit, we can give them a fruit to experience. But English subject is we can't give any subject like that so that they can experience and they can use it. So I find English is very difficult for this thing.
Actually, yeah. In fact, I'm very happy you asked this. I think English is a subject as a language. I'm saying it is the best to give them experiences. So suppose when we are talking about grammar, if we are talking about prepositions, it is so easy for a teacher to maybe, you know, kind of think of different places in the class and ask children or hide objects there and then give them clues with that. When you play a treasure hunt with words there, or there are you know, word puzzles and all to work for, when we are I'm so sorry, Zoom is sending me a message. Okay, so when you want them to learn about tenses, it is very important to give them real life scenarios that why we are using a particular tense, and those tenses are always taught in the form of relative ones. So when I'm telling them what is the difference between, say, simple past and past continuous and past perfect, the best example that I use is my mother was not at home. I don't know whether she's there now. My mother was not going to be at home, and my mother will not have been at home, or had not been at home. So, you know, they are able to imagine the different time lapses. I use a time scale to teach them about tenses. When I'm trying to give them, we generally play a word of, say, completing the proverbs or giving them scenarios and, you know, matching the proverbs with those, giving them experiences about types of words. Which word sounds good to me? Which word makes me feel happy? Which word makes me feel sad? What are the different, when we are talking about rhymes or when we are talking about lyrics, so at that time we try to use a lot of rhyming words around to tell us that how good it feels or how easy it is to remember if the lines are rhyming. When we are reading stories, children like to take up role plays, and you'll be amazed at how well certain children take up certain roles and do justice to them. So there are a lot of different ways of doing it. And of course, when I said maybe for higher class students and all, when you give them experiences, okay, you've written a speech, please deliver the speech. Don't only write it. When they are writing a letter, let them post it. Let them post the letter. Let them send the email to a real person. Let it not only be on paper, so that before clicking on the send button, they will themselves feel inclined to check for the errors and all, rather than leaving it for the teacher to mark it with her pen and all. So experiential learning, actually let them address it to maybe their own grandparents. I'm sure the grandparents will be happy to receive a letter from them, and the children will check 10 times before they just write, how are you, I'm fine, and end it up. So experiential learning comes in all subjects and all, and I think languages are the most easy to implement because they use it all the time.
Thank you.
Thank you everyone for joining. Are there any more questions?
No, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Oh, ma'am.
Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, have a great day. Have a great 2021. Very happy New Year to all.
Please the recording for a story session. I missed it.
I'll be putting it on Facebook. So you'll be able to see. And I'll also be putting it on the WGS page, the school page. So you can visit the Wockhardt Global School page and watch that. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye.